Rainbows and Radishes. A story of how God helps us deal with grief and loss. A nasty wind howled, then took full aim at the bog, with its trees bent low. It was considered normal at this time of year to expect such a powerful blow. Rain sliced the air, with grey dripping blades cutting through every bough and leaf, forcing critters to seek a dry shelter from a storm that brought cool, wet relief. Critters expected these storms now and then, and most would give them no mind. But every once in a very great while, there'd be a storm of a different kind. Every wise critter knew right away that you'd have to take every precaution because of the danger involved with the likes of a storm with such glaring proportion. Heavy clouds darkened, what lightning lit up, as critters huddled close for safekeeping. Daddy secured what the wind whipped and tugged, as mamas hugged little ones weeping. At the Biddleford house, the same scene played out, as the family clung on to each other, anxiously waiting their children's return. Twin girls and a younger brother. School had let out and they should have been home. Mama Biddleford started to pace. About that time, little Louis rushed in, running straight for his mama's embrace.
"Where are your sisters?"
Papa Biddleford asked, trying hard to hide his concern.
"They're eating radishes at Miss Peevish's patch. Papa, I'm not sure they'll ever learn."
"How many times must I fuss at those two about staying out of that patch? They know how angry it makes her. Now she may have to grow a new batch. I know they love radishes. It's their favourite treat. But they'll have to grow some of their own. Taking what others worked hard for is stealing radishes you haven't sown. Besides, this storm's getting worse and they need to get home. I've warned them of storms and their danger. Before this one is done, I'm afraid, my dear son, it'll end up a bog rearranger."
Meanwhile, at Miss Peevish's vegetable patch, Lily and Lolly were dining, stuffing handfuls of radishes into their mouths, with manners needing some refining. All the bog kids knew to stay well away from Miss Peevish, her things and her place. With rake in hand, she'd fuss threateningly, stomp her feet, then be on for the chase. But between the wind, the rain and the radishes, they never heard the tread of her feet. She came up behind them so suddenly, there was simply no chance for retreat.
"Gotcha!"
cried Miss Peevish, grabbing on to the pair, holding tight to their long floppy ears.
"Get out, you rotten little rodents!"
she yelled, reducing Lily and Lolly to tears.
"I'm sick of you wretched rabbits ruining my ruby red radish rose. I want you removed from my garden right now, before my rake and your rump come to blows."
Wet and all muddy, with tummies packed full, they scampered for home, hearth and shelter. But the storm had reached a furious pitch, turning the bog to a dangerous delta. They made it almost half the way home, trying in vain to cross over the creek, but its water rushed higher with every new gust. Reaching home and safety looked bleak.
"We'll have
have to try making it back to the patch,"
Lily yelled to her bedraggled sister.
"Maybe Miss Peevish will let us inside. The clouds look like they're forming a twister."
Forcing their way through the gale and their fears, they got back to Miss Peevish's place. They'd beg for forgiveness and ask for her help, knowing their conduct had been a disgrace. They beat on her door, pleading,
"Please let us in. A twister's about to touch down. It's heading this way, and it's dark, scary grey."
The door cracked, showing a peevishy frown.
"Come in, quick,"
snapped the snarly Miss Peevish. Unhappy she'd now have to give aid to the soaking wet pair with their deflated hair and their quivering selves so afraid. They spent that cold night in the corner, Miss Peevish never saying a word. Then sleep kindly overtook them all, the wind and the rain now unheard. The smell of hot pancakes and syrup tweaked noses, forcing open their eyes. A beautiful breakfast with a pot of hot tea sat waiting, much to their surprise.
"Surely this isn't for us,"
they whispered, staying close to the wall and each other.
"Wash your hands and face, then sit down and eat,"
said Miss Peevish, sounding more like their mother.
"As soon as you've eaten, I'm marching you home. It's the neighbourly thing to do. But if I ever catch you back in my patch, you'll be turned into rabbit stew."
The sun was up, but their spirits were down as they made their way home through the mess. Trees were uprooted, brush littered the path, the whole bog in a state of distress. The landscape had changed from the furious blows, and as they rounded some broken pine trees, the enormity of what this storm had done brought the sisters down to their knees. Where once had stood the Biddleford house, only twigs and a few limbs remained. Gone was their home and the family they loved. They'd been orphaned by a storm, untamed. As they sat in the ruins of their once happy home, anguish swept over each soul. Left all alone to fend for themselves, with a pain they could not control. Miss Peevish could bear it no longer, slipping off to get aid and relief. She'd find Hartley, he'd know what was needed, to ease their fear, their pain, and their grief. They slipped quietly back to the poor little pair, hearts breaking with theirs at the sight. Now, what would God do with this terrified two and their seeming impossible plight? They cried, they talked, then cried some more, Hartley offering the church till such time that a loving and suitable family was found who'd care for them for a lifetime. On the long walk back to the little bog church, Hartley told how God blesses the grieving, how he carries their burdens and eases their sorrow, if we trust him and keep on believing. When they got to the bridge, Miss Peevish took leave. She wanted to get back to her patch. More seeds must be sown and more vegetables grown, as the storm had destroyed the last batch. This time she'd set out twice the amount of that remarkable ruby-red radish. She'd plough lovely straight rows with her shovels and hoes, working into a state quite feverish. Back at the church, with Hartley to help, Lily and Lolly were healing. But their sorrow was deep, and for hours they'd weep, fearing no family would find them appealing. The weeks plodded on, one after the other, with nobody claiming the pair.
I guess they don't want to be bothered,
sobbed Lolly.
We're not wanted. I don't think they care.
But that evening at dinner, Hartley told of a home wanting to adopt the orphan pair. A small family who'd been through the very same thing, which would be a real answer to prayer. For the first time in weeks, they ate a good meal, and smiles were served with dessert. They'd be meeting the new family tomorrow, and perhaps then fully heal from their hurt. The next morning, Hartley led them to the bridge at the creek, where the new family would be greeting the pair. Excitement rumbled round their young tummies as they strode through the warm, boggy air. At the sound of the creek, they began to run for the bridge, their dreams and their wishes. But no family was there, and they turned in despair, for there was only Miss Peevish feeding fishes. Not sounding at all like her grouchy old self, she warmly greeted the pair. I came to see if you'd come home with me. I've a heart and a home to share. You probably think I'm a nasty old biddy, and you're right, that's just what I've been. I've kept everyone far, far away from me, as I've lived through your very same scene. I lost my whole family when I was your age, and decided to never again let anyone else that close to my heart, to protect myself from all that pain. But it took you two to open my heart and let me start living once more. Life without love isn't life at all, as God put love at life's core. Lily and Lolly were shocked and surprised at the change in Miss Peevish's heart. What she said, if true, they could all start brand new, for love is secure and won't part. With distance or time, with rain or with shine, as it seals to itself any soul who forgets about self, seeking God and His truth and His will, which has love as its goal. Arm in arm, they strode over the old wooden bridge to new life and new hope for the pair.
Oh, do you see what I see? Asked Miss Peevish with glee. That's a promise of God's love over there.
A rainbow fanned gently through a pastel blue sky as they stood silent in anticipation. Then the rainbow passed silently over the three, as God smiled on His new creation. The end. Or could it be the beginning? The beginning. Scriptures from the Holy Bible to help us with grief and loss. Matthew chapter 5, verse 4. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Psalm 34, verse 18. The Lord is near to the brokenhearted and saves the crushed in spirit. Psalm 23, verse 4. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Psalm 62, verse 8. Trust in Him at all times, you people. Pour out your hearts to Him, for God is our refuge. Revelation chapter 21, verse 4. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. there will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. Deuteronomy chapter 31, verse 8. The Lord himself goes before you and will be with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. John chapter 3, verse 16. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. This series was written in an effort to help children understand that no problem can overcome us if we are walking close to Jesus, trusting in his love and obeying his commandments.